This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and healthful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.
Could everyone please take a seat? I'd like to welcome you all to the monthly lecture sponsored by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii. We are a not-for-profit volunteer organization founded in 1990 for the purpose of promoting human health, animal rights, and protection of the environment by means of vegetarian education. We are among the largest vegetarian societies in the nation with approximately 2,000 members. Tonight's lecture is being videotaped for broadcast on our weekly TV series entitled Vegetarian. On Oahu, it airs on Thursdays at 6, on Olelo 52. We recommend that you tape each show in case you would like to see it again. If not, you can tape over it for the next time. Also, many of our previous lectures may be viewed online on our website, vsh.org, and tonight's lecture will be added to that collection soon. It's now time for our very special guest. We're delighted to have with us Vegetarian Society board member, Dr. Karl Seff. Dr. Seff earned his Ph.D. from MIT and has been a professor of chemistry at UH Manoa for 41 years. He has authored more than 245 scientific papers that have appeared in leading chemistry journals. In this presentation, he will discuss what we vegetarians are actually consuming and avoiding, and what sense does it make. Please welcome Dr. Karl Seff.
Thank you, Ms. President. Thank you all for coming. You have to be a little brave, as I've said before, each time I talk to come to a lecture by professor, because we're boring. You all know that. You know how boring we are. So I'm going to talk about what we vegetarians actually consume and what sense does it make. What do we eat and what do we drink? Well, let's answer the question. We vegetarians eat so widely. We eat many and drink many, many different things. All the foods in the health food stores, all the ones in the supermarkets and in the open markets, if we didn't eat those, they wouldn't be there anymore. Somebody is buying those things and we're eating them. We may choose to bypass certain foods if we're vegetarians or vegans, but we'll bypass other foods that are perfectly healthy just because we're not familiar with them. Of all the thousands of foods that are available to us, that are provided to us by our economic system, we tend to settle into just a few. Each of us eats a small fraction of what's available. And then we go home and we prepare them differently. So even roommates or couples who've been together for a long time will eat differently, even if they are both vegetarians or both vegans. They'll say, oh, he eats that, I don't like it, I eat this stuff over here. So the big question is, what should we be eating? Is this all right? Does it indicate that many of us are missing our mark? Should we all be eating more uniformly? I'd like to address that question. Well, each of us has our own tentative answers to what we should be eating, or at least has settled into a pattern. And I'm going to judge just by your presence here tonight and your presence at other meetings of the Vegetarian Society that we're ready to learn more and to modify our patterns. And this is very much to be respected. To have tentative answers, to live according to some principles, to have settled into a pattern which you think is the best, which is the best you can come up with, and ready to learn more, to modify where you're at, that is to be respected. And everybody I know who's a vegan or a vegetarian has changed according to this ready to modify principle, has changed over the last 5 or 10 or 15 years. And that certainly includes me. I've changed a lot. I thought I was fine 15 years ago or whatever, and I keep changing to my surprise. So let me tell you about some of my personal changes. You may recognize yourself in some of these. I used to think that whole wheat bread was a wonderful thing to eat. Whole wheat bread. Well, until I realized what the principal ingredient of whole wheat bread is. Enriched white flour. That is the principal ingredient of whole wheat bread. The second most important ingredient is whole wheat flour. So I changed to 100% whole wheat. If it doesn't say 100%, it's not really whole wheat. It's enriched white flour, which is a nice thing to avoid. Not a terrible food, but it's not as good as whole wheat. And then it was just a few years ago, in response to talks that I heard here, that I realized that whole wheat does not have the whole spectrum or a complete spectrum of fiber. And it's nice to eat oatmeal sometimes and some other grains. And so nowadays, I buy whole grain bread. Some people have kicked the bread habit altogether, deciding that it's been baked too much and is not as healthy as it really should be. But here's where I am. I buy something like 7-grain or 9-grain whole grain bread, and it's 100% whole, and it's a mixture of grains, and it has a broader spectrum of nutrients, in particular, including fiber. I used to be into cooking and recipes, and now about half of what I eat is raw. And the other half involves much simpler recipes. If you show me a recipe that involves mixing 6 things, I'll say that is 3 things over my limit. And it was just something like 5 years ago that I came to understand a result, relatively recent result of biochemical research, that the unbalanced intake of the omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids can cause a lack of absorption of the omega-3, which is the rarer. So that if you are consuming some oils that contain omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids, it is likely that you are getting a lot of omega-6 and that this is diminishing your body's ability to assimilate omega-3. And that leaves you with a shortage of an essential fatty acid. Essential as vitamins or minerals. It's essential. We have to have these two in our diet. Here's my history with nuts, that eating nuts does not harm health, and that this is a result of a large study, and they looked for correlations between people who ate nuts and something wrong with their health, and that correlation was missing. Since then, this was quickly expanded to include nuts and seeds, that seeds and nuts both have good fats, vitamins that are soluble in those good fats and not soluble in water, and they have a reasonable amount of protein. And so here I find myself eating nuts and seeds. And the last step that I've noticed is that if I eat them raw, then I don't eat too much. I eat some and I quit. I say, okay, that's enough. And so almost every evening I have some seeds and some nuts. I have some sunflower seeds or some pumpkin seeds. I almost always have flax seeds and Brazil nuts and almonds and walnuts and peanuts. And here I am eating these things, and I stop eating before I've eaten too much, because if they're raw, you don't get too far. A broad variety of nuts and seeds is nice, because if you eat a single one, just one or two, you may not get the spectrum of nutrients that you ought to get. And so that's a theme of what I'll be saying tonight, is it's nice to eat a broad variety within each category of foods rather than settling into a couple of favorites. Well, I'd like to point out that we are all in this situation. We are all in a similar situation, whether we're vegan or vegetarian or neither. And most of the members of the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii are neither vegan nor vegetarian, just interested in eating much healthier, just interested in going someplace to hear some lectures about food that will cause us all to be healthier, that will give us some clues. We really all lack the knowledge we need to make the decisions we need to make about food. We lack the knowledge. We know a lot of things, but we lacked a complete knowledge to make all the decisions. And so what do? We come to lectures like this one. We read articles and books. We maybe search the internet as time allows to learn more. And what do we find when we do that? We find some agreement, but we find a lot of conflicting advice. And we find a lack of information. And we even find hostility. We find people who say, you must do this. And so we're in the dilemma of trying to choose who and what to believe. And that's tough. That's always tough. Who do you listen to? What should you believe? And then while we're fussing with that, we get hungry and it's time for the next meal. And the next question is, what's in the fridge? And then you eat that. We all hope to get complete knowledge, crave for, seek sources of the truth about diet, about food. And in general, we seek to learn from others. We seek to learn from experts in the field. We can't all go around reading all the original studies critically. We hope to learn from experts in the field. We hope to learn from others. It would be nice to decide who is the wisest person and learn from him or her. And this is something that people often do. They just say, okay, that's the person. I'm following wherever he goeth, I shall go. Whatever he says, I'll eat that. I'll do that. Many of us try to follow a path that is a melding of the advice given by a number of people, the dozen wisest perhaps, whatever they agree upon, that must be true. And I personally do something like that. I also scan the internet and read some nutritional tables and books, but altogether I follow a path that is something like the mean of the approximately dozen wisest. So the time comes to pick a guru in the broadest and best sense, somebody to follow. And how shall we do that? And I'd like to do a little aside and give you something from Plato in Athens 2,400 years ago. 2,400 years ago, in the city-state of Athens, Plato offered an answer to who is the wisest, how to pick a guru. He offered a solution to that question. This is his book. I bought this book 52 years ago from the Cal bookstore on campus at the University of California at Berkeley because it was assigned reading, The Republic by Plato. And the issue in that book was, how shall we grow a future ruler? How shall we educate them? How can we prepare people to run the city-state of Athens? At that time, the total population was well under 50,000, and things that could happen to such a city-state would be invasion and destruction by people in the next country, like the Persians or the Spartans. He called these people citizen kings because they would not really be royalty, or philosopher kings because they had to know how to be able to think to handle the complex problems of running society. And he was very clear that there would be equal opportunity for women. The point was, in preparing a ruler, that the ruler would be faced with many important and complex problems, one after another, that did not have nice analytical solutions. So he or she would need special training, Plato concluded, to handle these important and complex problems. And here is his program, and I won't go through all of it, but basically up through 17 and 18, leave the kids alone and let them grow up with a minimum amount of compulsion. let them grow up in a rich environment of literature and music and arithmetic, but don't push them. And then at the age of 17 or 18, you push them hard. You give them intensive physical and military training. What's the military training? Well, this is 2,400 years ago. It's throw the javelin and spear the other guy. It's throw the discus and throw the shot put. It's run, cross-country running, position yourself for defense or for attack. Intensive physical training. And those people who did the best at that were then allowed to go to the next stage. And from 20 to 30, they did advanced math, whatever that was, 2,400 years ago, grasping the connections to reality. Plane geometry and solid geometry, they had a lot to do with measuring land. That was a big issue back then. And astronomy, harmonics, the seasons, and science. And that's what I really want to talk about. From 30 to 35, thought and dialectic, especially logic, and especially morality. After that, public service for 15 years to see what's actually going on. And finally, your chance to become leader of the country. And wow, a country needs a good leader. And so here was Plato's prescription for preparing a good leader. And let's talk specifically about this training from age 20 to 30, reserved again only for those that excelled at physical endeavors and military training. Advanced math, science, and engineering, so that the students could see that there were laws and principles that govern everything that goes on. They were able to prove that some sensible things are wrong, not just argue. But there may be some sensible things, and I'll list some for you in a moment. Prove some sensible things that are wrong. Prove that some nonsensical things that are nonsense. Prove that they're right, not just sit around and argue. Prove that some things that don't really make sense are absolutely true and must be true. They could have the opportunity to build something, put their best wits into building something, and see afterwards that it failed, and go back and criticize their own thinking to understand how is it that I've just built something marvelous and it doesn't work, or it just barely works. So in other words, let the natural world teach students how to think. This is different from the old teaching doctrine, from the old people teaching doctrine to the young people. This is true, this is true, this is true. Believe it, or you're going to flunk out. Let the natural world teach the students. Let it teach which ways of thinking are correct and which ways of thinking you can judge, the student could judge for himself, that was wrong. It led to an incorrect result or something that didn't work. The problems of diet are as complex as the problems of governance. The problems of diet involve you and your body and your health and your longevity. But Plato would recommend that we seek the advice of people who have been trained, as he prescribed, to handle problems that are complex. Nutrition is an appropriate science for this. Biochemistry is an appropriate science. Epidemiology and medicine is an appropriate applied science of all of the above. So let's talk about common sense. Common sense is a wonderful thing. We rely on common sense all the time. We need it to make our momentary decisions, a decision you need to make in 20 minutes from now or in an hour from now. We need our common sense. However, the results of common sense, the results of that reasoning, quickly disintegrate in the face of firm scientific findings. Let me go back a little bit. Don't eat nuts. They're too fat. Firm scientific findings, nobody gets sick from eating a moderate amount of nuts and seeds. Perfectly obvious things are often proven wrong. For example, by common sense, the earth is flat. We all know better nowadays. We teach our kids that that's not true. But it's clear to me that space is linear. Time and space are linear. Time is not has nothing to do with space. You go a certain distance north and a certain distance west, and you'll get someplace. If you go twice as far north, you'll be twice as far from here in a straight line. Well, Einstein said that's not true. And I personally have read about that, and I can't get used to it. But it's common sense to me that space is linear, and I'm able to drive here, get myself around town with the belief that, with assumptions that the Earth is flat and space is linear. Relatively common sense that a plant that has a strong scent could hold further magic. Rosemary with its sweet smell. Maybe there's something else that I could use rosemary for. The scent of eucalyptus. When I was a kid, when I got a cold, my parents would put me under a towel and with some hot water underneath, to which they'd added some eucalyptus oil, because they felt because of the scent that it could help me, that it could be a medicine. By common sense, the drugs that are for sale in the drugstores work. I mean, why are the drugstores there? And these are large, reputable companies. If you have an ailment, you go to the drugstore and you buy something that says it'll help you with your ailment. It is common sense that those drugs work. It is common sense that health food stores are here for the same reason, that the food in health food stores is healthy. We need to actively seek the knowledge that we need to be able to handle our own diets and those of the people who depend on us, spouses or roommates. I used to cook for two roommates, so I was in charge of what they ate, at least dinner. It doesn't come from the radio. I've been listening to the radio, as I've told you, driving down here. It doesn't come from television in general. It does not come from newspapers. It does not come from junk mail that might read your mailbox. You're exposed, we're all exposed to all of these things. And knowledge does not come from there. Bits of knowledge, half-truths, the worst thing. Partly true and partly false, the worst thing. We need to actively seek. The media gives us sales pitches. Buy this, buy that. You hear on the news that scientists in Canada have discovered, scientists in the Sloan Kettering Foundation have discovered that eating this or that drug may be effective against a certain health problem or disease. And that's on the news. And when it is established that it doesn't work, that's not news. That's pretty boring. That's 2 years later. We always hear this new substance, this new procedure may help people who have this problem. The manufacturers are selling their cereal. They say, a doctor recommended this to me for my heart problem, and so here I am eating this cereal. You all know the ad, I believe, from television. This beer is better because it has fewer calories. So drink this beer. There are so many ads on television saying this is a very good drug. Go talk your doctor into prescribing it for you. Radio personalities sell bee pollen and colon cleansers. Radio personalities. Is this what Plato prescribed as the people to whom we should listen for information on how to handle our complex problems? Even the health shows, whatever health show you may think of on television, and there's a number of them, must sell a variety of things to pay for their airtime. There are notable exceptions. Can you see it up on the screen? I can see it here, right down on the bottom. The radio program with Dr. Shintani, Dr. Nomura, and Dr. Heydrich is, well, they struggle for sponsors, and I'll bet if they don't find them that they chip in the money and pay for the airtime. And of course, the Vegetarian Society lectures are replayed on television. And these are nonprofit things. We're not selling anything. We're not selling cereal or beer or drugs or bee pollen or colon cleansers. We're not selling any. We're begging for money, but we're not selling anything. We're begging for a little bit of money. So knowledge does not come from food labels. This is a point that Jeff Novick made very strongly. You go to a store, you find a box of crackers or whatever it may be. You do not read the label. You turn it over on its side or its back and you read that black and white thing that the government made them print there. Do not even try to read the label. Reduced calories. Everything is shouting, buy me, eat me, drink me. We're under a barrage of that sort of thing. Let's try to remember what Plato suggested. Can you see everything with labels in the food stores dancing around and tossing their heads and saying, buy me, eat me, drink me? Look at the expense that goes into food labels and packaging. And there's no, the food labels in the health food stores do not get less happy. They're just as happy as the others. So once again, all of us need to actively seek the knowledge we need. We need to read articles and books and check the credentials of the people who wrote them, people trained in science, in nutrition, and in medicine. You can come to these lectures and you can read our monthly newsletter, and I'll be quoting something out of this newsletter in a moment. You can go to vsh.org, which has links to lots of other websites and an opportunity to see more than 100 of these lectures. The whole lecture, you can sit in front of your screen and watch it for 50 minutes, 60 minutes. You can subscribe to one of several magazines, for example, the Vegetarian Journal, which is produced by a nonprofit organization, the Vegetarian Resource Group, vrg.org. Or you just work the internet. Google something. Google vegan. Google vegetarian. Google low-fat recipes. Google low-fat vegan recipes. You can learn so. You need to actively seek this. It is not coming to you by means of television, radio, newspaper, or whatever might appear in your mailbox. So I'd like to, this is a quote that I like very much, and I'd like to use this as a lead-in to my next segment. This is a quotation by Lessing, who was a German philosopher, and I've translated this from the original German, and this is a loose translation, but it gets the point. It is better to learn from people who search after the truth, and don't stop doing that, than from people who know it. Because the truth is a little unreachable, at least with respect to dietary matters. And it is better to learn from people who are trying hard to understand it better than from people like the two people I heard on my car radio as I drove in, who knew with certainty what you should do to improve your health and to change your diet. So, with all of that background, and that was a college lecture, I think, I will tell you my personal views. I'm just going to shoot off at the mouth now and tell you my personal views on lots of issues involving food and health. On each issue, the question will be, what's true? And on each issue, my response will be, I don't really know. I haven't read everything. I'm still trying to read things. I'm still trying to learn from people. I come to pretty much all of these lectures. My answers will be, I don't really know, but since you're asking, here I go. And the basis of what I talk about will be death and disease. So here are some statistics. These are the number of people in Hawaii that died in the last year that I could find on the internet, which was 2005. 2,319 people died in Hawaii in that year of heart problems. And so on down the list, you can see the numbers. This third one would be stroke. Something after that is accidents. Somebody pointed out already that mistakes that take place in hospitals is not listed over here. There might be some overlap between some of these. Here are some more things that have been listed as causes of deaths. There's all these other people that died of other causes. I don't know, degenerative muscular disease and so on. I'm not a medical doctor, but there's lots of causes listed for death. And my criterion will be if nobody dies of something, and if nobody has gotten sick from something, then we should not be afraid of it. And we should pay attention to those things that people die of and people get sick from, and we should be mindful in our choice of diet to avoid some of these great problems. And the basis for deciding would be scientific studies, the results of research, the accepted opinions of people whom we can accept as experts by Plato's criteria. So let me start at the top, health food stores. You're not going to like me when this is over. Maybe you don't like me already. Health food stores, I'd like to make an observation, are not run by research scientists. They are not run by registered dietitians. They're not run by medical doctors or anybody in the health sciences. Perhaps it's all for the best, because health food stores, like every other company, need to make a profit. Nowadays, they need to keep from going out of business. They need to be run by people who know how to run a store. From an economic point of view, I don't think you'd want to stick a medical doctor in charge of a health food store over here and see what happens. Maybe something wonderful will happen and it'll last 3 months. And then you won't have a health food store. So I'm not criticizing the fact that it's not run by these people, but I'm also making a point. What they sell is not necessarily healthy. Alternative food stores might be a better name. I'm going shopping at the alternative food store. There I expect to find foods that I would not find in a normal supermarket. Health food stores will follow a fad or a craze. If everybody decides a certain thing is good, health food stores will carry it just to get the business, whether it's healthy or not. Sometimes it's healthy, sometimes it's not healthy. I'll mention a few things. Raw chocolate that has not been processed. Noni. Goji berries. I'm not making a comment. All of these are vegan foods. All of these have nutritive value. I go there for alternative foods like imitation meats, imitation cheese, vegan cheeses, vegan meats. Hope to find something whose fat content is not too high. The vegan potato salad is a great treat, although it has too much fat for me. And the veggie chili is fine. Does not have very much fat in it. So I go to health food stores to get these. I'm not denouncing health food stores, but once again, they're not the authorities in the field of health. For example, let's just talk about soy sauce, shoyu or tamari, whichever name you recognize the best. Bragg's Aminos for a long time said that they had less sodium, far less sodium, that you should use Bragg Aminos. Well, I went to some health food stores and some regular stores and read what it said on some soy sauce containers in my own kitchen. And here are the contents of milligrams of sodium per tablespoon. There is no salt in any of these preparations. The amino acid is a sodium salt of a peptide, of a single member of a protein chain. It is not sodium chloride, it's sodium peptide, whichever peptide it is. You can't get rid of the sodium. It doesn't have sodium chloride that can be taken out. And these are the contents. They're all pretty much the same. Kikkoman light, like any other soy sauce that is light, and therefore they can say contains less sodium, is simply diluted. They added water. Now when you take a tablespoon of it and put it in your preparation, you've added less because they've added water and it costs less. It should cost less. It's been diluted. Otherwise, these numbers are essentially all the same. And if you go to look at the Bragg's Aminos, no longer says that it is low in sodium and better than other soy sauces. It no longer says that because at this point the government has required that the sodium content be listed. And the sodium content is listed. Its sodium content is listed as 160 milligrams per half teaspoon. That's a good way to get a small number. Divide by 6. That'll make it smaller. If you multiply the 160 by 6, you'll get 960. Same as all the rest. And after that, wow, people who know their soy sauces will know that there's a certain expensive one that tastes far better than anything else, and so on and so on. It's a matter of taste. Garlic. I spend a lot of time in Korea. People walk up to me all the time with a big smile on their face, and they point at some garlic on the table, and they say, good for health. Wow, almost everybody says that to me with a big smile, good for health. Suzanne Havala has spoken here in the past. She's a leader in the American Dietetic Association, to which most registered dietitians belong and which produces the Journal of the American Dietetic Association. She is a leader of the vegan resource group, the vegan group amongst dietitians in the United States. And she wrote an article in the Vegetarian Journal, a feature article, almost an editorial on the early pages. There's no special advantage to garlic. And my opinion, I believe her. Other good vegetarian books say otherwise by people whom I respect. But I believe her because I do not know of anything that has been isolated from garlic that is particularly magical. It is a little vegetable. Little vegetable. And it's a perfectly good vegetable, I think, as good as the others, except it's a little one. But I do not believe that it is a magical thing. But all over the world, all culture, because it has a pungent odor, because it seems like a good thing, magical properties are given to garlic, good for health. Organic food. First of all, before I begin with organic food, I would like to say something about organic farming. And that is, organic farming is, I'm talking about the foods that we eat. Organic farming is not really the subject of my lecture. But organic farming is something that can make use of animal waste as long as our country produces so much of it. Organic farming is something that can protect our topsoil, which is being eroded all over the place. Organic farming can allow us to use less fertilizer so that we'll have less runoff into our rivers and streams, and there will not be a huge dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico, for example. Due to these fertilizers running off and having algae grow and bloom because of that fertilizer. There's a lot of advantages to the environmental advantages to organic farming. And now I'd like to go further, having said that we need to distinguish genetically modified and chemically treated food. So I'd like to separate the foods that have been genetically modified and the chemical treatment part. We had a lecture at the university two Thursdays ago, a lecture given by Professor Pamela Ronald, who is a geneticist, a professor at the University of California at Davis, which is the agricultural campus of the University of California system, and her husband, who is an organic farmer. And they came along together in a harmonious manner, and they spoke about how our food might be grown in the future in a way that will provide enough food for the expanding population of the world, in a way that will preserve our fields and our topsoil and our good insects. So they quoted these numbers. In the world, there are 300,000 deaths per year due to chemicals used in agriculture. These are primarily due to chemical pesticides or herbicides in third world countries where care is not taken in the administration of these chemicals. And this is the number of deaths that are due to genetic modification, this number. And their statement was that the harm that can come from genetic modification is the same as the harm that has come from all of the plant breeding that has taken place over millennia. There is no harm. Breeding to make a better orange has not hurt anybody. And breeding by new modern methods to generate new organisms has not hurt anybody. And there is nothing here to be fearful of. And so personally, I don't care if something says it's organic or not. Perhaps for environmental reasons, I would care. But in general, I do not think my health is affected. This is my bottom line on organic food. I personally wash my food, wash my lettuce, especially if I see a little grit in there or some little bit of dirt from someplace, mostly to get rid of the filth, animal waste, maybe some human waste, maybe some farmers are not as infinitely careful as some of the rest of us are. I wash my food more to get rid of filth, perhaps more especially if it comes from a roadside stand or an open market, more to get rid of the filth than the chemicals. I'm not particularly worried about those. Chemical pollution, organic chemicals, PCBs, DDT, dioxanes, heavy metal impurities, mercury and cadmium are two that come to mind. These are scary words, and they are scary. All of these are scary substances. And I think and hope that we're all doing all we can to keep them out of the food, out of our food. As citizens, I think our government does a pretty good job at keeping these things low. DDT is illegal in the United States. When some countries in Africa say that we have thousands of people dying from malaria, will you please give us some DDT? The U.S. government says no. It says, oh, we're going to start some other program. We'll do something else, but we're not going to give you DDT. We'll end up being blamed for that when some of your citizens die from having DDT buildup in their systems. So I don't know what to say about all these, except they're terrible and we need to avoid them. And the government generally watches over a lot of these things and keeps them off our shelves. And we hear warnings. You watch the news to see what's new or to see who won the ball game. And the government says that you shouldn't eat peanuts. And that's on the news. And that's last month, 3 weeks ago. And of course, eat low on the food chain. A lot of these chemicals get concentrated as you eat further up. So eat plants rather than animals. Aspartame, or NutraSweet, seems entirely safe to me. It is a simple dipeptide. It is the smallest possible protein. It quickly is disintegrated in the stomach acids to give two amino acids, which is what we expect to be done to any protein that we ingest. This will happen fast because it's so small. I drink diet soda with some frequency, so I don't drink a lot of soda pop, but I find it convenient to go to some fast food joint, buy a senior soda, they hand me an empty cup, and I put soda pop, and I work on something that I'm working on, and I get a couple of hours of good work in that way, and so I drink some of these things. Back to artificial sweeteners. Aspartame, NutraSweet seems entirely safe to me. Stevia seems safe to me. I looked up the molecule. It's a big, complex carbohydrate that somehow has a very strong sweet taste. I don't know if there's any particular reason to use it, but I think it's perfectly safe. Sucral, frankly, scares me a little bit because there's three chlorine atoms attached to that molecule. It's approximately the size of a sugar molecule, but it has three chlorine atoms attached to it, which makes it something like a chlorocarbon. And the reason it's used is because the sugar survives baking. The molecule is sufficiently stable so that if you bake at 350 degrees Fahrenheit, aspartame begins to break apart and lose its sweetness. Raw foods. Okay, let's say something perfectly obvious and true. We evolved to eat raw foods. Before we domesticated fire, before we started cooking things, we were pretty much at our present state of evolution, and we ate what we could find, and it was all raw. Unless a lightning bolt had just hit something lately, it was all raw. Unless we're living in New Zealand and we're able to stick something into a volcanic fissure. We evolved to eat raw foods. But here's something else that's true. The nutrients in cooked foods are more available to the body. Cooking breaks down the cell walls. The cellulose of the cell walls are broken down by cooking. And therefore, the stuff inside the cell has a greater chance of being absorbed into your body. Surely some components of food are destroyed by cooking. Surely there must be some erosion of food quality due to cooking. But I believe there's relatively little loss or harm at temperatures up to that of boiling water. So I steam things all the time. I do not buy a crock pot. Juicing. A lot of people do juicing. Maybe not as much as before. There's lots of advantages. You can eat more things raw. You can throw a whole orange into a juicer, complete with the peel and complete with the seeds. And there's some nutrients there, and so there's some nice flavor that can come from the peel. if you don't juice, I'm sure almost all of us throw the peel away. There's some nice flavor. You can buy those flavors, Angostura bitters. You can buy the flavor from the peels and use that in some other way. But there's some disadvantages. I don't understand why people would do that and then throw away the insoluble fiber. If you can think of a way of using the, there's waste, there's some fiber on the side that doesn't come in the juice. That should be eaten, just like the whole food should be eaten. It'd be a little bit better for each of us, if we, for people who juice, if we ate the whole food. So don't throw away, figure out a way of eating that. But isn't chewing good for the teeth? Aren't we supposed to be using our teeth? How about the jaw? We got a jawbone, we got a jaw muscle. Wouldn't it be nice if we use that? How about our psychology? Aren't we supposed to eat things? Maybe we go nuts if we stop eating. Isn't eating supposed to be nice for us? You sit there and have a nice meal and you burp, and I think that's good for the psychology. Why bypass eating? Fats. Saturated fats, the short ones are okay. Coconut oil has been a bit of a craze lately. Coconut oil has no special nutrients, but who knows? Maybe it's good for something. Maybe it's satisfying. Maybe if you eat something that has a teaspoon or a tablespoon of coconut oil in it, afterwards you'll say, I'm full sooner, and eat less. Maybe it's good for that reason. I don't know. Otherwise, no special nutrients. Longer chains, saturated chains of the fatty acids are deadly. Heart disease, leading killer. Trans fat. Our government says that the maximum daily intake is zero, should be zero. How much should you eat? Well, a zero or less, our government recommends. If you're eating a little more than zero, that's too much. And finally, we absolutely positively need our essential fatty acids. And we need to think about how to keep our omega-6 content down and our omega-3 content up. And the way to do that is to avoid adding large quantities of fat. Olive oil, half a cup of olive oil, half a cup of Wesson oil, half a cup of... Don't do that. That really gives you huge amounts of omega-6. And eat something like walnuts, the flax seeds are the big heroes that have some omega-3. We need to understand that all of the good results of science that advise us that we should eat a lot of vegetables and fruits and whole grains and that we should be vegans for the best optimal health, all of those results are based on the products of our agricultural system. It's based on the products of our agricultural system, whatever it is. And so those foods need to be eaten. They can be... organic or not, in my opinion. But they need to be eaten. Socially offensive foods. You got somebody living with you in your house, in your bedroom? You got somebody there? You might want to avoid some of these things. I had a student from Korea one time that told me that everybody in Korea eats garlic, everybody in Korea eats kimchi, nobody in Korea complains about anybody else's breath. So there. Beans are a marvelous food. The fattest bean is the soybean. Eat a lot of soybeans, a lot of tofu, you're getting a reasonable amount of fat. You get half that amount of fat if you eat garbanzo beans. Relatively low, all of these things are not really high in fat, neither of them are really high in fat, but all the other beans have negligible fat. And they're good food. They're relatively high in carbos, and they're certainly high in protein. And fermented soybeans, here are some stinky things, stinky Japanese food, stinky Korean food. I don't know how to pronounce the stinky Chinese. You get these jars of with little squares of tofu inside soaking in brine. They've been fermented, they stink really bad. And a little bit of that on a bunch of steamed vegetables, it makes it delicious. And I advocate steamed vegetables, but I don't like them. Not plain. I don't eat that. Now let me emphasize how little we know. Everybody thinks that we know everything. The people who write the nutrition books used at the universities contain everything, or that the tables produced by the Department of Agriculture on the content of all of our foods contain all the information. We don't know everything about the composition of our foods. When I heard about goji berries, I wanted to look up their composition. I wanted to see the numbers. I couldn't find it in the tables. United States of America doesn't know about goji berries. It wasn't in the tables, and the same was true for noni. I wanted to be authoritative. I wanted some numbers. I couldn't find them. There's some nutrients in our foods that are routinely not listed. Only about 20 components of food are listed. The vitamins, the minerals, the fat content, the degree of unsaturation of the fat. Well, there's lots of other things in foods. Foods are very complex. And most of the components of foods, the amounts cannot be found anyplace. We don't know everything about the composition of our foods. The foods we eat, we do not know the value of various foods to our individual bodies and how it varies with age and sex and with the individual. So that is why, here's the standard advice, and then I'm saying it again, we need to eat, for best health, we need to eat a wide variety of vegan foods. If we eat a variety of vegan foods, we're almost sure not to be missing something, some quality, some component of food that is not listed in the tables. And there are many of those things. Of course, we need to avoid refined foods. This doesn't say don't eat any ever, but in general, avoid refined foods. Avoid oils that come in jars, except by the teaspoon for flavoring. Nothing can't be anything too wrong with that. White grains and flours. Even heads of cabbage. Do you think a head of cabbage looks like the cannonball that's for sale in the supermarket? A cabbage plant has nice green leaves around it with a central kernel that is the head of cabbage. They rip those off and sell you these cannonballs in the markets. I was able to find a nice real. I would like to go through the garbage bin at the supermarket and get those beautiful green leaves, dark green leaves of the cabbage plant. Those have to have some extra nutrients as compared to the cannonballs that are for sale. Hearts of romaine, very tender, very delicate. Give me those green leaves on the outside. I can't complain about dried fruits. They've been processed a little bit, but generally not at high temperatures. Here's a little bit of refinement that can't be really considered bad. How to eat healthfully. I'm getting down to standard advice. Green leaves. My first thing is green leaves. Green leaves are high in trace metal nutrients, and they're high in antioxidants. And that's something I talked about when I talked about antioxidants about 2 years ago. Vegetables, a rainbow of colors, and none of these colors are white. And that's a mistake. One of these letters should be missing. White vegetables are okay. White potatoes, cauliflower, these are not evil substances. But a rainbow of color, think about colorful things. Yams, potatoes, variety of potatoes, onions, whole grains, beans and legumes, seeds and nuts, have a place for them in your diet. Fruits, we're getting into the candy of the vegetable world. A broader view of how to eat well, follow the general vegan principles, but enjoy your personal tastes. There is something to the wisdom of the body. Honor your personal tastes. Within the limits of the general vegan principles, sometimes your body is trying to tell you something. You should be eating that. You should be eating this. Don't eat what you ate last night. Your body says, I don't want it. Don't make me eat it. It's just like as with parents do with kids. Your body says, don't eat that. Sure, it's healthy, but don't eat it. You ate that last night. Eat something else. So the general rules of health, getting down to the basics. If you want to be healthy and live a long life, I should break into song sometime around here. Genetics are important, diet is important, and exercise is important. And all of this assumes that you don't smoke, which will wipe you out pretty well. And you're not suffering from extreme physical or emotional stress that keeps you from getting a decent night's sleep and works you to death in one way or another. Assuming that you're not suffering from any of these, then these are supposed to be, and I believe are, the three components of health. But still, there's a strong message here. Take care of yourself. Stay out of hospitals as best you can. And when you've finally finished ruining yourself completely, oftentimes the doctor will say, well, try this, try that. But he will be kind enough not to tell you that you've spent your body and I can't do anything to fix it. And I'd like to end on this current TV advertisement, something I saw on television. I was amazed to see it. Our country is becoming educated, and some company has decided that a statement like this will have an audience, that people will look at that and believe it and buy their product. And that's a great progress by our movement. Thank you very much. Chairs need to be stacked high if you feel you've got a little bit of energy. Refreshments from Down to Earth are available in the back room. Please enjoy them. Thank you very much for coming, and please come next month.
This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and helpful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.